It's Saturday at 9 p.m. and guess what? It's time for Celebrity Fashion Designer. Today, I'm here with the gorgeous Kyerewa Atakorah, the founder of April Rust. She's made some great outfits, are very complimentary, and today we're going to meet her. Hello, my dear.
Hello.
How are you?
Good, thank you.
Nice to meet you in person.
Nice to meet you too.
Super. The first time I actually encountered your name, you've done some beautiful pair of trousers for Kojo Youngson.
Okay.
And I was thinking, wow, I could do with one of those. So I thought you only make clothes for women, right?
Yes, but I do make exceptions.
I'm going to be one of those exceptions because I'm coming to you with a design right after the show. Okay, well, listen, nice to meet you. The name, April Rust.
Yes.
Where's that come from?
Okay, so in the very beginning, I wanted to go with Renaissance, something that symbolizes a rebirth. But I thought the name was slightly played out. I wanted something fresher and a little more memorable. So I did some research. Turns out April symbolizes newness. When the plants hibernate, they come back to life in April. And then rust denotes decay, oldness. So when you put those two together, it becomes a renewal of the old, which in essence is a rebirth. Wow. So that's what April Rust means. It represents a rebirth because I'm from a generation of dressmakers. So I wanted a name that represents a new line of dressmakers.
I like that part about, you know, the new and the old. It's quite interesting that.
Thank you.
So, I've seen some of your outfits. I checked them out on Instagram. And your outfits will fit anywhere. I'm like, these are outfits that will probably make it onto the catwalk in Paris quite easily. I'm sure you agree with me.
I do.
I don't see much of an infusion of African influence. Am I wrong?
In some regards, yes. The thing with our design process is we try to take inspiration as opposed to taking the actual influence. So whereas usually you'd see the print and immediately know, okay, this is African, we would take symbols, things that connote, you know, the African story or certain elements of the African story. So you'd find that we might do some beading that might be local, or we might use some feathers that might have, you know, an African heritage. So I rarely use the actual print. I prefer to make my own, you know, interpretation of what African art really is.
I like that. And I think to be African is not necessarily to have kente on you.
Exactly.
It's about the influences, the style, and the coordination of all that I think really works.
Yeah.
So I've got to say also, how many people call you April by mistake?
Oh, let me say 4,000, really? Like 600. Yeah, just as many as Instagram followers I have.
I've done it a few times while I've been here. I was like, hi, April. Like, no, her name is not April. Her name is Kyerewa Atakorah. Well, okay, listen. Every designer hits a block at some point. I ask this to almost all the designers.
Okay.
For you, how is your working schedule? Is it hectic? Or is it you take it very calmly? Or do you sometimes get to a point where you just think, I need to go away and just reboot? How's it like for you?
A bit of both.
Yeah?
Yeah. Generally, it's hectic because, as you know, it's not unilateral. We don't just do the creative part and leave the rest to work. There's a lot of behind-the-scenes management. And for me, the business side of it was kind of a shock because when you're a creative person, you're all about your styles and the colors and the fabrics. But when you get into it as a career, you really need to pay attention to what keeps you relevant, what keeps the money coming in. So there's a lot of balance that we need to find. I need to be in the workshop a lot. I need to be in the design room a lot. I need to be at my table, checking my record, seeing if we're, you know, doing good. So it is quite hectic, but I'm learning, well, let me say, I have learned to let the people who are qualified do what they can do. So now I have, you know, a very good team, very efficient. I'm able to more or less give people tasks, which gives me enough time to also focus on others.
I like that. You know, I'm very creative myself.
Okay.
And I think
I can
it's very important.
With the jacket.
Oh, thank you. I think it's very important for people who are in this industry to hear it from people like you, that being creative enough does not build you a business.
Yeah.
And you've got to take consideration of the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that you can sketch, draw, come up with the creative ideas, when you actually start to run your business.
Yeah.
This is the reason, one of the reasons why we're running this show, for up and coming fledgling designers to learn something from it. We'll be right back. You obviously had some affiliation with Lisco and you won some competition, right? Tell me a little bit about that.
Okay, so it was a Fashion Fan Award in aid of Women's Month, something they introduced in 2013. So mm-hmm. I actually won the first edition.
Oh, wow.
And it was a $10,000 cash prize.
$10,000?
Oh, yes.
Have I got, is there any left around for me? Well, or has it all gone into the establishment?
Most of it went in, but then we're doing good, so.
Wow. So your journey then, it's not been that straightforward, has it? It's I read somewhere that this wasn't originally your career path.
That's correct.
Somehow you turned. Tell us about it.
Okay, so straight out of university, I wanted to get into the Foreign Service. So I found myself at Foreign Affairs for National Service. And I did like it, to be honest, but I found that everything that was fashion related that came my way, I literally wanted to ditch work and go do that.
Wow.
And that happened 3, 4, 5 times. I thought, no, the gods are telling me something, if not God himself. So I just put that on hold and started, you know, looking into fashion more. And that's just about the same time I won the competition, which for me was very strategic because I really was at a crossroad. So since then, I've gone full front into the fashion industry.
And also, you stumbled on, not, you didn't stumble on fashion. This is something that is apparently part of your makeup.
That's
genetic
true.
Makeup.
That's correct.
I'm sure my viewers would like to know what that's about.
Okay, so my mother sews, and my mother is a twin. Her twin sister sews as well.
Wow.
So, and when I say sews, they're both fashion designers.
Wow.
Her twin sister lives in England. She stocks Harrods. She's really good. And my mother was doing children's clothing for the longest time, but now she's evolved into, you know, adult clothing. My grandmother sews, her mother before her, and the one before. So sewing is really something that is part of our family.
So no schooling about sewing whatsoever? Or have you had some kind of refresher course?
To be honest, yes. I
and
did
where?
Have a refresher course at the Pratt Institute in New York.
Okay.
It was a 2-month intensive, and it's actually for professionals. So you do need to know your way around literally every, you know, design room. And they only involve us with the masters and polish us up, really.
Wow.
So I did have extensive knowledge on the subject.
What other schools have you been to?
Oh, I went to Wesley Girls High School.
You went to Wesley Girls?
Oh,
wow,
yes.
My wife went to Wesley Girls.
Lovely.
She'd be ecstatic about this particular show. I see, that's good.
Good choice there.
I know, right? It was apparently Wesley Girls. Apparently, I went to Adesano College, but apparently Wesley Girls
so
produces.
So did all the men in my family. So.
Really? Mm-hmm. They went to Adesano College?
Yeah.
I like that already. Brilliant. So I'm family now.
You are.
I get all my outfits free at a discount. But anyway, listen, I'm just intrigued. How old are you?
I'm 26.
26?
Yeah.
Wow. For an established designer, that's quite young, huh? You've done
that's
very
what I
well.
Hear. I feel quite old, though.
You feel quite old. So I guess marriage is around the corner.
In the pipeline.
In the pipeline. I like the sound of that. Please make sure I'm invited.
You will be.
Brilliant. Well, listen, I'm sure you have something planned for us in terms of an outfit.
Yes.
So it will be interesting for the viewers to know where your ideas come from.
Okay.
And maybe you're going to sketch us something as well, are you?
That'd be
wow.
Nice.
Can't wait to see what that looks like.
I'll pick something from the Ella Sampson collection.
Ella Sampson collection? Okay.
It's in honor of my mother.
Okay, okay.
So, here it goes.
Do all artists have to know how to, all designers have to know how to draw?
No, really.
No?
Now I'd say you can hire anybody for anything if you so lack it. But it helps, it really does help when you can sketch, you know, for clients and
they can actually visualize.
Yes.
They, so interesting. You can actually sketch, right?
I can. Yeah.
So is this a minimum requirement?
I'm decent.
Decent sketching. It's all. I guess it's all good for your clients to be able to see.
Yeah, definitely does help if you can. Mm-hmm. But then I will say now people study this professionally, So if you can't also, you could very well outsource, you know, a good
sketch artist.
Exactly.
I see. So this looks interesting. What can I see at the moment? I'm looking at some kind of blouse, right?
Yes, it is. So the collection basically gives new meaning to wardrobe staples, which is the very simple things that every woman should have in their wardrobe. Mm-hmm. But what we did this time is to just revamp them, make them a little bit more special than you would know them to be.
Right.
So this is a pencil skirt.
Okay.
And a chiffon blouse.
Pencil skirt and a chiffon blouse.
Yes. Okay. But then we added some feather detailing.
Feathers?
I think that would be nice.
Now that's interesting. You said something about feathers being African, right?
I know. I did say.
Not many designers actually venture into the whole feather industry.
but
you like to use it, right?
I do. I do like them a lot. I mean, they have... I'm into tribal influences. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't necessarily have to be Ghanaian. I would lean into anything that connotes Africa in some terms. Mm-hmm.
So that, I definitely think that works with the feathers as well. What else would you put feathers in, apart from an outfit? Would you use it to cut accessories and...
Yes, we haven't merged into accessories full front, mm-hmm. but then we have done few pieces for particular.
Okay. Interesting. Just some lines or pleats. What am I looking at?
They are pleats, yes, okay. but I plan on doing something inverse. You understand when we get there.
Ooh, can't wait for that. Something inverse. To the layman, that just looks like lines on a skirt, but
they're
I'm sure
not lines.
There's a whole lot more to it than that.
Very difficult lines.
Okay.
But yeah, in essence.
Okay. Wow.
Let's give her.
Impressive sketch.
I hope you can see what I'm doing.
I can definitely see what you're doing.
Okay, and there's hope.
I actually draw, you see, so I.
Oh yeah.
I appreciate it.
Okay, let's give her some hair, and then we can go.
Brilliant. Wow. Beautiful hair. Should we give her some earrings as well? I'm just kidding. Okay. So.
Okay.
Wow. Nice sketch. So we're gonna you're gonna translate this.
Yes.
Into. A garment for us, right?
That's great.
And you're going to take us through the processes.
Yes,
I can't wait for this.
Me neither.
Let's go see how it works. Come on.
Okay, sure. Set up the toile. Basically, we'll do all the cutting on this first.
Okay.
The usual process is from here, we go onto a mock fabric, and then you go onto the real fabric.
Oh, mock fabric. Okay. I've not heard that often. Not many people have mentioned that.
Right.
So we always prefer to go to a mock fabric.
Yeah. Technically, it's called a toile, but then for purposes of this, we just call
so
it
that. So when we were younger, mock exams was a trial leading to the actual
exactly.
exam. So why is that necessary? Is that to avoid potential mistakes?
Yes, and sometimes we make alterations on the mannequin. So you wouldn't want to waste, you know, the original fabric if it's a very high-end dress and every meter is a couple of hundred cedis. It saves you both money and time.
Interesting. So I think certainly for my viewers that will be something worth learning for
definitely.
Those up-and-coming fledgling designers. Okay.
So we're starting with the top. Mm-hmm. You essentially fold your brown paper into two. Mm-hmm. Because it's got an opening in the front buttons, I need to create a panel here. So this panel you see here is what I have folded on this
I see.
Edge.
So pretty much that is here.
Exactly.
And this brown is the rest of the top.
Yes.
Okay,
correct.
Okay.
So now what we're going to do is to take out the neckline. So this is freehand sketching, by the way. There's
That's interesting. But you carry on.
There are different ways.
Have you seen any of the previous shows?
I have seen
okay.
A
few of the other designers are not keen on freehand sketching.
Okay.
So, because of they're worried of the margin of error.
Right.
What is your take on that?
Well, there are pros and cons to each. Mm-hmm. I prefer freehand cutting for certain things.
Okay.
So this really is a simple blouse, mm-hmm. which is why I can afford to do the freehand cut. It's loose, it's shift, it only has the dart lines for some emphasis around the bust.
Okay.
But outside of that, if it was a fitted dress, bustier, anything that is a little technical, we would use the pattern. Okay.
So now is the cutting of the neckline, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. So we get our shoulder line here. 4-inch margin. We measure our dart lines. So the measurements aren't there, but I know them.
You know them.
So, shoulder to nipple line.
I guess for somebody who was born with this gift, born to sew or born to design, which one would you prefer?
It's a little easier. Born to design.
Born to design.
Yeah. Because you know how creative people can get. One day you're sewing, tomorrow I'm designing a bookshelf, I'm painting the next day. So it's always varied. So it's a bit like math. I mean, you go with your lines, you go with the numbers, and then you do the calculations as you go. So this, in essence, is the block of the shirt. Mm-hmm. This is the shoulder line I've drawn here.
I see that.
The neck hole is out here.
Yeah.
This is where the darts form. This is like the nipple point. So in essence, if we cut out the armhole to meet that. Mm-hmm. This would take the shape as we make it.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. I can see it now. Before I couldn't.
Right.
When I first started this show, now I can actually see it when the brown paper goes on. So you're going to cut around the blue.
Exactly.
And then you've got your form. Is it folded? So we have two sides.
It is folded, so you'll have the same thing on the other side.
On the other side, right, okay.
So we could do the cutting now. It's always best to leave enough room because we're going to add, you know, the stitches, so then essentially it'll be smaller than what you've cut.
Are you taking into consideration a seam allowance here or not?
That's what I meant.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, so see, you know all the terms already.
I'm learning.
I tried to be kind by
giving me the layman's words.
So that's okay. So now we need the side off.
Okay. Voila.
So we'll have the same thing on the other side. Mm-hmm. We open that out.
And that's our top right there.
That's our top right there. Mm-hmm. As we go on, we'll add the sleeves and then finish the dart line.
So can we open it and have a look at what that looks like on the... Okay, so that's the total...
width of it. Right. So, I mean, once the darts come in here, you're going to have it start to take more of a feminine form.
More of a shape there as well.
You'll have a crease here. You have this split into two.
Okay.
This side going in. So essentially,
it looks like something like that. Okay. So this is now going to look with.
This is the fabric we're using, right?
It is.
So this will look like that.
Yes.
And where are the. I remember you put the feathers along.
The waistline.
The waistline. So this is going to come somewhere here, right?
Okay, so this it's two-piece.
It's a two-piece,
right. This is a skirt that is a pencil skirt, and this is the top.
Okay.
So this is the fabric we want to use for our skirts.
Okay.
This is going down all the bottom.
Okay.
But we want to make
this
it a little
special. This is
the surprise
you were telling me about.
It
the
is.
The paneling or something.
So
right.
Literally what we're going to do is cut the fabric into little strips now.
Okay.
See if I can show you what that's going to look like. About this thick with this fabric.
With this fabric.
Raw edges. We're literally going to stitch them onto this fabric.
When you say raw edges, that means the edges have been kept frayed. Right, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
We're going to stitch them in a linear form.
Oh, I see. So we'll have the yellow, we'll have this color on top of that cream.
Exactly.
In raw
edges.
Okay.
And then the feathers come at the waist.
Okay, so is the feathers attached to the top or is it attached
to the skirt?
It's attached to the skirt.
It's attached to the skirt.
It gives you a multi-purpose for the skirt. You can wear it for different functions as well.
Okay. Exactly. It's a very versatile look. If you wanted to dress up the top a little bit more or dress it down a little bit less, you can wear with shorts or leggings or jeans.
Yeah. It works.
So this is what we're doing.
Fantastic.
fantastic. So I can't wait to see what this looks like. Because now we've seen the conception of the idea, part of your range. We've seen you cut it. We've seen you describe what it's going to look like.
Yes.
And now we have to see what the finished article looks like, right?
Yes.
Well, we've seen the conception of the idea and we've got to meet the personality as well. I certainly can't wait to see what the finished article looks like. We're spending some time with Kyerewa Atakorah off April 1st.
Okay, so this actual piece is from our latest collection called the Ella Samson Collection. Now, I named the collection after my mother for three reasons. Number one, she's a very simple person.
Right.
So most of the pieces you'd find are very fine wardrobe staples, simple blouses, pencil skirts, A-line skirts. That's the theme we're going for. Secondly, she's elegant. So I was looking out for pieces that make the average thing look a little more different from the usual. Lastly, she's memorable. Whatever room she steps in, we're not going to forget her. I know you've met her, so you can testify.
I must admit, and I didn't all describe her very aptly.
Right, so basically it's things that every woman should have in their wardrobe, pieces and items that you should have in your closet, with the little extra detail that make it something more special.
The extra detail for me, I think the feathers.
Exactly.
One of the only, if not only designer I've spoken to so far, that's actually doing things with feathers.
I think
it's interesting, exciting. It is.
Can
I get away with feathers on my clothes, or is that not going away from
me? From April, so we might find a way to make it work.
So I think this really works. I think the outfit has turned out great. And I want to say a big thank you to our model for the job well done, and all the other models that have come and done a grand job. Thank you so much, Kyerewa. It's been an absolute delight.
Wonderful to meet you.
Your outfits are totally gorgeous.
Thank you.
And a big thank you to all our models for a grand job they have done for us today. Today we spent some time with Kyerewa Atakorah, the founder of April Rust. Thank you so much for joining us on this edition of Celebrity Fashion Designer. Make sure you stay tuned same time next week. My outfit was made by Kuja Clothing. Thank you.